What's up, everybody? It's Soren Baker here on Unique Access, and today we're joined by Arabian Prince.
Yes, sir.
Thank you for coming through, sir.
Anytime.
Yes, yes. So your legacy is a very long, very extensive, and resonates today. And one thing I think is important is explaining how before you were in NWA that you were a solo artist having success as a producer and as an artist.
Right.
So with that being said, when you were understanding the business of the music, what did you get creatively and business-wise out of being an artist, and what did you get out of producing JJ Fad and the other people you were working with?
Right. Well, you know, for me, the whole process of starting on my own, so it's different if you come into a group and somebody else has done something, and you come in and you're just a part of it and you're rapping or making beats or whatever. But to do every step of the way on your own, because I was, 15 and a half when I started to make my first record. And I was like, I don't know. There was no internet back then. You had to figure it out on your own.
Right.
And I just heard other people making records. Like, oh, they're making records on the East Coast. I was down with Uncle Jam's Army and Egyptian Lover and those cats was making a record. I was down with Dre and Yella and the Wrecking Crew at the time. We were all just DJs. Mm-hmm. And we hadn't made records at all. But everybody started talking about making records. And really quick, how that happened was, it's the craziest thing. DJing, and I couldn't afford an 808 at the time or whatever, you know. So I bought this drum machine from a toy store called Sensonic Drums. It was Mattel.
Okay.
Had little four little drum pads and some toms on it. It just made little sounds. And I would DJ and stop DJing and bang on that on stage, and people kept dancing. And I'm like, all right. And then I would say little stuff on top of it, and I'm like, okay, this is cool. I can make a record. And then hanging out with Egypt, he finally got an 808 and started banging on that. And I was like, oh, this is hot. And he said, yeah, man, we about to go in the studio, me and Roger, and, you know, we're going to make this record. And I got to see them make the record.
Wow.
And I was like, all right, I want to do that. But, you know, I'm 15 and a half, 16 years old. I don't know any better. So I go in the studio by myself with I think I had like $1,000 I had saved up. I had 500 and somebody gave me 500 this guy I used to work for. And I literally walked into a recording studio with nothing, man, and came out with a record, you know, at 16. So for me, the step by step, making a record, then having the actual record tape, what do? Oh, everybody's going to McCullough, which was the West Coast distributor at the time and record plant. And I went there and got lucky and bumped into my boy, I'm brain dead right now. I bumped into my boy Bobby Jimmy, Russ Parr, who had the morning show on K-Day.
Right.
And he was in there doing some stuff with Don McMillan, who owned McCullough at the time, and he had his own records coming out. He had just done the Bobby, Jimmy, and the Critter thing.
Right.
You know, I think he just done We Like Ugly Women, which I think it was Egypt did that one for him. And we were talking, he's like, well, who are you? What you doing? I'm like, well, you know, blah, blah, blah. I'm about to drop this record. And he's, oh, you're that DJ dude. I'm like, yeah. And he's like, well, why don't you be on my label? So I went on this label, but I was able to go to McCullough all the time and kind of check on my records and check on my books and look at the royalty statements and everything. So it kind of gave me this sense of business even before, you know, NWA.
Also before NWA, of course, you add your solo material. And then I would say the biggest thing was producing the JJ Fad as far as commercially,
right,
and breaking through. So getting with them, like, how did you figure out the right thing to do with them? Because, you know, we had the real Roxanne and Roxanne Shanté. We had a few female rappers that had been prominent, and then some others like Sha Rock that never came out and were big.
Right.
So how did you figure out how to twist what they were before into making Supersonic? And
well, that was kind of a trippy thing, because me and Dre used to mess around with a couple of girls in the original group, because there were originally five girls. Mm-hmm. And what a lot of people don't know is JJ Fad stood for each girl's name. Mm-hmm. It was Juana, Juanita, Fatima, Annie, and Dania. That was JJ Fad.
And then they had to switch it.
And then they had to switch it up.
Right.
And I think they call it just Jammin', Fresh, and Deaf or something like that. So we used to mess with a couple of the girls out in Rialto. We used to drive out there all the time. And Dre was, you know, like, saying, like, and, you know, they keep asking me that they want to rap or whatever. I ain't mess with them. They whack. And I was like, all right, well, we ain't gonna mess with him. And one day I just happened to be in the studio working on, I think, a Professor X record, because I'm also Professor X. Mm-hmm. So I was doing this Professor X record in the studio, and I had about 4 hours of studio time left over. Okay. And they were just in there watching. And they talked me into it, like, oh, we want to make a record. Come on, you got some time left. I had an 808 and a Yamaha DX7. That's all I had in the studio. Hmm. And we did two songs. We were talking about what we want to do, and they're like, well, we want to battle. You know, we're going to talk about Roxanne. We don't like them. So I'm like, hey, they can rap.
Right.
Like, real Rox- right. Roxanne Shantae can really rap.
Right, right.
But it's how we want to do it. So we came up with this song, you know, Another Hope Bites the Dust, and we did right. that. And that was supposed to be the song we were going to do. And then I had a little more time left, and I was kind of not feeling easy about that Another One Bites the Dust song, Another Hope Bites the Dust song, because I'm like, she going to come back and tell y'all a new asshole. Because y'all really ain't rappers like that. Mm-hmm. So I said, let me whip this song together really quick, Supersonic. You know, I'm good on the up-tempo, this banging beat. So I whipped that out real, real quick. We wrote something real quick. Boom. Put both out. I got, you know, I put them out on my boy's label, Dream Team Records at the mm-hmm. time. And Another Hope Bites the Dust was side A, Supersonic was side B. Went out, went to K-Day. They might have played it for a hot second, and then they flipped it over. Supersonic blew up, mm-hmm. and we had to go back and repress it as just Supersonic, and mm-hmm. that's what happened. But it was just kind of, for me, you know, you guys are girls, you're not the, I'm not saying y'all whack, but y'all ain't the greatest rappers, do something that's party. I was always a party DJ, so I heard that, and that's what happened.
Right, and then also building on that, the perception, I think, too, with the West Coast was more of that sound at the time.
Right.
But it was so different for, you know, the female rappers that were going on in New York primarily. So why do you think JJ Fad was able to get through with that song in a way that, you know, when other female rappers had faster tempo records, they didn't succeed really ever almost?
Yeah, yeah. Because it was my banging ass beats. No, just kidding. No, dude, it was the 808. Like, you drop anything with an 808, like an 808 in the 80s and right. open up that kick, and you put that thing on, as soon as that thing hit, it just boom, you know, in the club it sounded big. And also, too, I think because the way they rapped, it was kind of like this back
like
and forth thing,
team
like a tag team back and mm-hmm. forth thing, and it was smooth. And then they had that, what do you call it, double dutch. Kind of thing at the end, mm-hmm. you know, that
baby D.
Oh, yeah, that killed it. So I think that's what, it was a novelty that everybody jumped on and loved.
Okay. And then once you saw that record take off in a way that nobody in the circle really, I guess, turn off the lights, maybe.
Yeah.
But not, I don't even think that was nearly as big as Supersonic, even before the remix. And
yeah, because Supersonic went number one on Billboard.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So Turn Off the Lights was big, but yeah. around the crew, like, you know, a lot of people, I think, don't understand or appreciate the fact that that really helped finance or help break open what NWA did, what yeah. Eazy-E did. So for you, seeing how things changed thanks to Supersonic, beyond financially, what changed with you guys around?
Well, Jerry Heller is what changed financially for us. I mean, I just be honest about it, you know.
Okay.
And that's why I left, because I had this big record. And my homeboy, Rudy Pardee, you know, rest in peace, right. wasn't the best businessman with me when I put it on his label. So I had to take the record back. And we had just started Ruthless Records. And I'm like, okay, I'll bring that over here and help that finance what we're doing as a production team and right. as NWA and everything else you want to do. I'm not that cat. I ain't never been that cat that's like, oh, this is all mine. I'm going to, you know, hoard it. I'm about the family. You know, we family. Let's use this to build what we want to do. And that's what I had done. And then when Jerry Heller got involved, that all changed, you know, because we were sharing everything equally money-wise from like the first NWA joint. We would just get boxes of records, and here's your boxes, whatever money you make, that's your money.
Okay.
Which is cool. You're getting your money direct. But when Jerry Heller got involved, the money wasn't coming to you direct no more. You had to go ask for money. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, well, this is my money. Why am I asking you for my money? And then with Supersonic, this is a big hit. It's selling like major records.
Right.
And it's my record and the girls' records, and we can't get paid. I'm out.
Right.
So I did my little deal and I got out because I don't trust you and I'm not going to stay here regardless of the fame of NWA or the fame of Supersonic and deal with this. I just need to get paid and move on and do my own thing. So that's what I did.
Now we're going to get to Orpheus in a second.
Yeah.
But I did want to know and understand for you personally and professionally when the NWA and the Posse record came out and then Straight Outta Compton came out, like when Something to Dance To was removed later, mm-hmm. do you know, did you understand or know why they took it off the later pressings?
Yeah, well, a couple of reasons why. One, okay. A named person who I ain't gonna say who run the label, they want to pay me. and two, okay. they felt that like probably, oh, it doesn't fit the album.
Okay.
You know, but you got to understand why we did that initially.
Wasn't that to hedge bets to get on the radio?
Well, that's what it was. It was right. Because you got to understand, Dre from the Wrecking Crew, me doing what I did, that was the sound of the West Coast.
And Yellow.
Yeah, that was the sound of the West Coast. And even Cube, you know, the one he did before with CIA, it was kind of a different kind of sound.
Right.
But that was the sound of the West Coast. And if you're going to drop a gangster rap album, you need to know that you can get radio play. And they really weren't playing that stuff back then. So we dropped at first Panic Zone to get the radio, you know, and that record kind of blew up a little bit anyway. And then on the Straight Outta Compton, it was like Something to Dance To was thrown on there just for the same purpose to get radio play to let people know, that, oh, there's a new NWA joint. You know, it's all about fun. Boom, put it out there and move on. So that's what was up with that. And it worked. I mean, it actually worked its purpose to do that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And then once it, you know, wasn't on the album, did you, like, what was your feeling, reaction? Like, what did you notice about it?
No, I mean, I didn't care. I mean, you know, for me, I ain't that person. I don't care. And I think, and actually, it's still on. It's on some and not on some. So yeah, it just depends.
It just depends what version.
Yeah, it depends on what version it is. But, you know, I don't care. You know, I still get paid.
Be sure to check out The History of Gangster Rap by Soren Baker. He's official.
History of Gangster Rap features exclusive interviews with Ice-T, Snoop Dogg, MC Ren, the D.O.C., and dozens of others. The History of Gangster Rap, a definitive look at how Los Angeles changed rap forever.
In Los Angeles, the streets definitely set the tone of the hip-hop music.
At 19, I got a $50,000 car.
My whole angle always was, I'll be street, but I will always tell you the horrors that go along with this life.
There will be penalties and casualties for just wearing the wrong color in somebody's neighborhood.
And once gangster rap made it from the streets to the TV, the genre exploded.
What's that, Five on your TV back with NWA?
Yo MTV, it just catapulted us from being local heroes to national gangbang rappers.
The History of Gangster Rap discusses it all from 1980 up till today.
It's always gonna be shit happening in the streets. You know what I mean? So it's always going to be something to talk about.
The History of Gangster Rap in stores now.